Today we're going to continue on in our series on the 23rd Psalm. We're calling God's Antidote to Stress. And we found that within the 23rd Psalm, there's seven major stresses in life that all of us face, but we've also discovered that there's also seven antidotes to those same stresses. And so today we want to look at the subject of God's antidote to indecision, because indecision can create a tremendous amount of stress in our lives. Being indecisive or not knowing what to do or not knowing if you did the right thing, it can create a lot of stress in our lives. So once again, let's read the 23rd Psalm. I'm going to read it and you follow along, but see how much you can do from your memory. All right, here we go. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And now may God add his blessings to the reading and the preaching of his holy word. And all of God's people said, amen, amen. Amen. You know, life is a series of choices, and life is a series of decisions. And success seems to lie in the ability to make the right choice at the right time. It seems like that's where success lies for most folks, making the right choice at the right time. You see, we make our decisions, and then our decisions tend to make us. Now, because every decision has a consequence, and because we're human beings, which means that we are prone to make mistakes, decision-making can become very stressful, because none of us wants to make bad decisions, right? Nobody wants to make a bad decision. And so, have you ever been afraid? Have you ever been afraid to make a decision because making that decision might be the wrong decision, and so you don't make a decision? You ever been there? You ever done that? I don't want to make the decision because I'm afraid it's the wrong decision, and so I won't make a decision. Well, that we've all faced that kind of stress. In fact, some of you may be facing a major issue this very week, and you're saying, what do I do? You know, do I hold on to this or do I let go? Should I get into this or should I not get into this? Should I get married? Should I not get married? Should I have children? Should I not have children? For those of you who have children, it's too late for that decision. Amen? Too late. All right, so... Should I get a new job or not get a new job? Should I change careers or not change careers? Should I go to college or not go to college? If I go to college, what college should I go to? Can I afford it? Can I not afford it? And the stress of indecision begins to get to us sometimes, and it begins to put a lot of pressure on us. And sometimes, even after we make a decision, we start second-guessing ourselves, and we say, did I do the right thing then? And then we waver back and forth even after we make our decision, and that causes stress. Now, is there an antidote to the stresses that comes from this kind of decision-making? The answer is yes, of course there is. And the antidote to indecision is found in the third verse of the 23rd Psalm. As we move through this psalm, we come to the third verse. Let's read it out loud. It's up on the screen here. Let's read it out loud together. You ready? You ready? Nice and strong. Here we go. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Wow, there you go. The antidote to the stress of decision-making is to simply let God guide you. The good shepherd not only feeds us, but he also leads us. He not only provides, but he guides. He not only protects, but he also directs. That's what he does. And God has said that if we let him, he'll guide us through this journey that we call life. He said, I'm going to guide you in the paths of righteousness. So what does that mean? Well, the paths of righteousness just means the right path. He wants to guide us in the right path. In fact, some translations of this passage literally says he guides us on the right path. If King David were saying that today, he'd say, he keeps me on the right track. He just keeps me on the right track. And would you agree that it's very easy to get off the right track in this life? It's easy to get off track. It's easy to get so involved in trivial things, for example, that we fail to do the important things in life. And so we end up majoring on the minors and we get off track. It's very easy to get off. See, if you're majoring on the minors, you're off track. Amen? You're not going God's direction. You're doing something that is just a minor thing, but God wants you over here, but you're over here. But God can keep us on track. Now, some folks might say, well, now, Pastor, I've done this. I've asked God to lead me. I've asked God to guide me. But things just seem to be getting more confusing than they were before. I just can't seem to get clear guidance from God. So why is knowing God's will so difficult for some folks? I mean, is God playing games with us? Is God playing hide and seek with his will? No, not at all. God doesn't do that. In fact, God not only wants to guide you, but listen, folks, I'm telling you, he wants to guide you more than you probably want to be guided. Amen? He wants to guide you more than you want to be guided. In fact, God wants you to know his will perhaps more than you want to know his will. You see, one of the problems that a lot of people have in finding God's will is that all too often they're looking for the wrong things. When they're looking for God's will, they tend to look for it in the wrong ways. For example, I put on your outline there the wrong approaches to God's will. And you see, when some people begin looking for God's will, they'll take the wrong approach. For example, here's letter A on your outline. They'll take what I call the mystical approach. Just write that in there. They'll take the mystical approach. And so what they're really looking for is some kind of a feeling. They're looking for a quiver in their liver, some kind of an emotional experience to show them the way. You know, just a little goosebump feeling. You know, oh, that must be the right way. That's the mystical approach. But then letter B, others have a little more who are a little more logical in their thinking. They tend to want the methodical approach. The methodical approach. They want to know God's will methodically. They want God to give them a recipe or a formula of some kind. They're looking for five easy steps, you know, bam, 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 and now I know God's will. They're looking for the methodical approach. Then letter C, there are those who are looking for the magical approach. The magical approach. And so what these folks are looking for is for God to do some kind of a fantastic sign. You know, God will write it in the sky, or he'll call them on their cell phone, or he'll give them a dream. Just some dramatic sign. But the truth is, all of those things lead to frustration, and they ultimately cause us to miss God's will because, listen, none of those things work. None of them work. They never have, and they never will. See, God's will is not a feeling. And God's will is not a formula. And God's will is not something that God wants you to be frustrated or fearful about. It's not what he wants. So how do I let God guide me in the right path? I wrote this on your outline there. How do I get guidance from God? Number one, the Bible says basically you need to do four things. The first is this. First thing I need to do is just admit that I need a guide. That's pretty basic, but you got to do it. And for some, it's harder than you think. I got to admit that I need a guide. I admit that I need a guide. Now, this is the starting point, and the truth is, it is really tough to do, especially for men. Because, you see, when men are lost, the last thing that they want to do is to stop and ask for directions. It's true. Guys will not set aside their pride and stop and ask for directions. It's tough for men to do that. Why? Because it's not the manly thing to do, and we want to be manly men, not girly girls. And so we're not going to stop and ask for directions. Men just don't naturally do that. I mean, most men would rather drive 800 miles out of their way than stop and ask for directions. And a lot of guys have done that. A lot of guys have done that. I mean, you've heard the old joke, why did Moses have to wander in the desert for 40 years? Because men refused to ask for directions. Did you know that sheep, by their very nature, tend to just wander off? That's what sheep do. They just tend to wander off. They tend to wander away, and then by nature, they get off path. And so they need a caring, guiding shepherd to lead them. That's why they need a shepherd to lead them down the right path. And so do we. We need that too. Because look at this next verse, Isaiah 53:6. It says, every one of us have strayed away like sheep. We have left God's path to follow our own. Wow, that's pretty clear, isn't it? Let's read that together. You ready? Let's read it out loud. Here we go. Every one of us have strayed away like sheep. We have left God's path to follow our own. See, this is the real problem as to why a lot of people don't find God's will. Because the fact is, most of the time, we don't really want to follow God or anybody else. And folks, this goes for Christians as well as non-Christians. We just want to go our own way and we want to do our own thing. We don't want somebody, anybody, we don't want anybody, even God, telling us what to do. We want to do our own thing. We tend not to want to follow anybody or anything else. And so we certainly don't want to admit that we need direction. And certainly we don't want to admit that we need a guide. But that's exactly what we need, whether we recognize it or not. Now, of course, sheep do need a guide because sheep have very poor vision. Sheep cannot see very far ahead of them. They're very limited in the distance that they can see clearly with. They don't know if the path that they're heading down is going to lead them into a fire or into a dangerous situation. They need a shepherd to lead them because their vision is very poor. And the same is true for us because like sheep, our vision can become impaired as well. In fact, we can't see into the future. We can't even see 10 years from now. Folks, we can't even see tomorrow. We don't even know what tomorrow's going to... Wait, we don't even know what this afternoon's going to bring. That's how limited our vision is. Our vision is very poor. We can't see further than just maybe now. So we need somebody to guide us. God has created us. Listen, He created us specifically with the inability of being able to see into the future. He put that limitation on us for a reason. You know what the limitation is? You know why we can't see into the future? Why we can't see beyond just where we're at right now? It's because God wants us to learn to depend on Him to be our guide. Now, the problem with sheep and with us is that because we can't see very well, here's what happens. We tend to stumble a lot. We tend to stumble a lot. In fact, look at this next verse, Proverbs 14:12. It says, "There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death." Have you ever made a decision that seemed right at the time, but it turned out later on to be wrong? Yeah. You ever done that? Yeah. I made a decision. It seemed right, but man, was it wrong. We've all done that. See, there's a path that seems right, but the end is a dead end. And we've all been there. We've all gotten off the right path at times, and we've taken the wrong path. And as a result, we stumble in our lives. We stumble. We have to pay for it. We made the wrong decision financially. I bought that car. I thought it was the right thing to do, but I shouldn't have done it. And now we're paying for it. We stumble, right? I invested in this. I thought it was the right thing to do. It looked good, but it seemed right. But now it's falling apart. We're losing money. We're having to pay for it. We make these decisions like that sometimes, and they seem right, but they end up really bad. See, what we need to do is to set aside our pride and humbly admit that we need a guide for our lives. Look at the next verse, Psalm 25:9. It says, "He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them His way." Would you circle the word humble right there? Just circle that word humble. Because humble just means that I set my pride aside, I go ahead, and I admit that I need Jesus to guide my life. I can't do it without Him. We need to get before God, humbly admit, "God, I can't do this without You. Guide me, Lord." So the first step to knowing God's will and defeating indecision is to just admit that I need a guide. And once I've done that, I move on to step number two, which is this number two on your outline there. I ask in faith for direction. I ask in faith for direction. You know, the Bible says, "You have not because you ask not." That's what it says. You have not because you ask not. In fact, look at this next key thought on your outline there. Jesus said, "Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you." The first letters of ask, seek, and knock are what? A-S-K. Ask. Just put that in there. So God wants us to what? Ask. I did that twice because I want you to get the message. God wants us to what? Ask. To ask Him. Really ask Him. But when you ask, ask in faith. Now, what are we to ask for? Well, look, when it comes to making good decisions, you know what we need to ask God for? Wisdom. Amen? Amen. I mean, look, if you got a decision you're going to need to make, if you're facing a decision right now, you're not sure whether to turn right or left, you need to ask God for wisdom. Now, in fact, look at this next passage, James 1, 5 through 6, out of the Living Bible. I like this paraphrase. It's really good. It says this: "If you want to know what God really wants you to do, ask Him, and He will gladly tell you. For He is always ready to give a bountiful supply of wisdom to all who ask Him. But be sure that you really expect Him to tell you. Because if you don't ask in faith, don't expect the Lord to give you any solid answer." Well, there it is. It says here that God's willing to give wisdom. In fact, He is anxious to give wisdom. He's waiting to give you wisdom. He wants to direct your life. But you got to have two things in place for that to happen. In fact, I wrote that on your outline there. Two things that's needed to receive wisdom. Letter A, first of all, you must ask the right person. Just write that in there. You got to ask the right person. Who's the right person to ask? God. That's the right person. Ask the right person. You ask God. You don't ask a psychic. You don't ask a medium. You don't ask a professor at college. You don't ask your parents. You don't ask anybody. You don't ask a friend. You don't ask anybody first and foremost. The first person, the most important person you ask is God. "I need wisdom, God. I need Your wisdom. God, I'm asking You. I need to know what to do in this situation." And then secondly, letter B, you ask with the right attitude, which means that we're to ask in faith. And that's the attitude. It's an attitude of faith. I'm asking in faith. Have you ever asked God for something and then didn't really expect that you would get it? Have you ever asked God for something and didn't expect you'd get it? Some of you have, and that's probably one of the reasons you didn't get it. Because we didn't ask in faith. And that's because God works in our lives according to our faith. I mean, sometimes we'll pray, "God, please guide me," and then we'll just get up and we'll go on our own way. God, please guide me. Here I go. And we go our own way. And we don't give God a chance to guide us. We don't even wait 5 minutes to see if God won't give us an impression or an idea. But we just get up and we just go on our way anyway, even though we ask God for something. But we ask it in a way that's not really in faith. You see, listen, if you do something in faith, it means you're willing to trust Him to do it. You're trusting Him to show it. You're trusting Him to reveal it. You're trusting Him to open the door. You're trusting Him to do it. So you don't do it. Amen. If you do it, it's not Him. You wait for Him to do it. That's the hard part, though, for most of us, is waiting. See, God promised us wisdom. In fact, He said that He would give us a bountiful supply of wisdom. So what is wisdom? You know what wisdom really is? Wisdom is just simply being able to see life from God's point of view. If you can see life from God's point of view, then you can have all the wisdom you need. See, wisdom's the ability to do that. I mean, wouldn't you like to be able to have the ability of being able to make decisions like God makes decisions? Amen. I mean, God is never indecisive. Did you know that? I mean, God always bats 1,000. God never makes a bad decision. He never makes a mistake. And He says that if we'll trust Him and listen to Him, He will guide us with that kind of wisdom. But we've got to ask God in faith for direction. Ask God, expecting Him to give it to you. I expect God to do this. I do. Do you? Do you know how to pray that way? To trust God enough to say, God, I'm not going to move until You give me an answer. I'm not going to move until You give me direction. Oh, I'll go on with my day, but concerning this issue, I'm not going to do a thing till You give me direction. I've had to do that the last couple of weeks. I've had to trust God to give me direction in some areas. God, I'm not going to do a thing until You make a move. Until You move this or move that or show me, I'm not going to do a thing. I'm just going to wait for direction. And He's given it. And so now I know what I have to do because God gave me direction. He gave me clear direction. No doubt about it. It was God. See, God always knows the right thing to do. So when He guides us, we're going to go in the right way, in the right path. Amen? Well, once you've done that, step number three is this. Number three, I need to listen then for God's response. We're talking about listening, so I need to listen for God's response. Now, do you realize that in this room right now, in this air around us, this room is filled with radio waves and television waves, cellular phone signal waves. They're all around us. There's all kinds of messages flowing through this room right now. All kinds of messages. I mean, there's thousands of them. You can't see them. You can't hear them. But if you had the proper receiver, then you could tune into that signal and you could get the message. I mean, the messages are here right now. But unless you're tuned into the proper wavelength, you're not going to hear it. Now, why is it that a cell phone can pick up a cell phone signal and we can't? Well, it's because that cell phone was created by its creator to receive a specific signal. It was designed to pick up that kind of a signal. Now, you were created by your creator to hear His voice. There is a special receiver inside of you that enables you to hear the voice of God. There's a special receiver built inside of you that enables you to be able to hear God and get guidance from God. God wouldn't have made you without that capability. You have the ability to tune in to God and to get direction from God personally. You say, well, then how come I never hear from God? I never hear from God. Well, it's because there's a variety of reasons, but one is you may have your receiver turned off, which means you've never established a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. In other words, you're not saved. You know how you get your receiver turned on? You get saved. The Holy Spirit takes up residence. The Holy Spirit is the receiver. He's inside of you now. When you get saved, you receive the Holy Spirit. The receiver gets turned on. But if you're still not hearing from God, it may be because you're away from the receiver all the time. In other words, you're so preoccupied with other things that you're not even listening. You just don't listen anymore. Or it's because you're tuned in to the wrong channel. See, if God's on channel 13 and you're on channel 4, you're not going to pick up God's guidance for you. You're just not going to get it. Now, the truth is, God is speaking all the time. But most people, most Christians, are just not really tuned in. Look at the next verse on the outline there, Job 33:14. It says, God does speak, sometimes one way and sometimes another, even though people may not understand it. So why wouldn't we understand it? Well, it's because we're not tuned in. Well, then, what are the channels that God uses to speak us with? Come on, Pastor, tell me, how do I get tuned in? I'm glad you asked. There's a lot of channels that God uses and speaks to us through. Let me give you an example. God speaks to us through, first of all, here's on your outline there. Let me just go through these real quick. God speaks to us through the Bible. That's the first way. Through the Bible. Letter B, God speaks to us through godly Bible teachers. Through the Bible and then through Bible godly teachers. And then letter C, he teaches us and speaks to us through impressions. He'll speak to us through the Bible, through godly teachers, and then through impressions. Letter D, he'll speak to us through circumstances. Through the Bible, through teachers, through impressions, through circumstances. Letter E, he'll speak to us through pain. So the Bible, teachers, impressions, circumstance, pain, and then letter F, he'll use a combination of all the above. He'll use a variety of those things sometimes together. Sometimes I've known people who have heard from God through all of them. And he used all of them at one time. Boy, listen, if God has to use all of them on you, he really wants to get your attention. Amen. You better pay attention. Amen? He's really trying to get you tuned in. So let's go through these a little bit one by one here. Of course, the primary way that God speaks to us is through this book we call the Bible. That's why we call the Bible God's Word, because it's God speaking to you and I, and a lot of the direction we need for our life is already inside this book. Listen, the truth is, most of the direction you need to live life is found already in the Bible. See, God says that life is a journey, and he's given us a roadmap, that's his word. He's given us a compass, that's our conscience. He's also given us a personal guide, that's the Holy Spirit in us. When you're lost, when you don't know which direction to turn, it helps to have a compass, it helps to have a roadmap. But I'm going to tell you, the best thing to have is somebody who's already been there, done that. Somebody who's already gone the journey, because then they can guide you through it from their own experience. They can take you through it. See, the Bible is God's guidebook, and if you don't read it, then you're going to get lost. But God's Word will help you navigate and negotiate the mazes of life. That's why we need to read God's Word every single day. Every day. Because if you're not reading this book every day, or at least parts of it every day, it's like having your phone off the hook. It's like having your cell phone with only one bar. I heard the message on Sunday, but that's just one bar. If you want to get a good signal, if you want to get all five bars on there, or six bars, or whatever it is, you got to read God's Word every day. Amen? Amen. That's what you got to do. Someone says, well, God never speaks to me. Well, are you reading his Word every day? You say, no, I'm not reading his Word. Well, then, how can you expect God to speak to you on a regular basis? You got to read part of his Word every day. You need to read God's Word, fill your mind with it so you can know God's will, because God's will is primarily found in God's Word. I've been praying and working on my barber 15 years now. I've been going to the same guy for about 15 years now. I've been praying for him and been talking to him, and just, you know, every chance I get, just putting in a little bit of word about the Lord here and there and stuff like that, and just waiting for God to open the right door. And I've been praying for him. I'm saying, God, you open the door, I'll step in. I won't be bashful. I won't be afraid, but I don't want to push it. I don't want to push him away, because I don't want a bad haircut, Lord. This guy's cutting my hair. I want to get as good a job as I can get, all right? I've been praying for him, and I was the only one appointment he had for an hour and a half. And he finished he cuts my hair. It's rather quick. I mean, he does my hair in about 15 minutes, and I'm done, you know. And so he we're standing there talking about guns and stuff like that. We both have the same kind of gun. We bought the same kind of gun and stuff like that. So we're talking guns, bullets, stuff like that and everything. And he goes, ending stuff, you know, because we're talking about shooting and people getting shot and stuff. He goes, talk about things ending. He goes, wait a minute, I got something to show you. I thought he was going to go get a gun and come out, because he's done that before. I got a gun and brought it out and we've looked at it and stuff like that. But he goes to the back of the room and he comes out with a book, and it's a book on end times. And he goes, somebody gave me this book, Pastor. He goes, look at this book. He goes, it talks about the end days. And you know what it says, Pastor? It says that nobody really goes to hell, that there really isn't no such thing as a hell. Isn't that good to know? There's really no hell? And I go, who wrote that book? Let me see that book, you know. And I look at the book, and it was published by the Church of God. And it was, which was kind of surprising to me, but it was published by the Church of God. There was a booklet saying that there was no hell, and that heaven, and nobody goes to heaven until after the resurrection. So nobody's in heaven right now. Everybody's just waiting in this medium. You know, it's that kind of a teaching and stuff like that. And so I looked at him and I said, look, this is a good, this is terrible. And he goes, what do you mean? And I go, because it's not true. And he goes, what do you mean it's not true? And I said, it's not what the Bible teaches. And he goes, well, they say it's what they use verses in there. And I said, they take those verses out of context. Like they build a whole theology, a whole doctrine around verses out of context. I said, it's not what the Bible teaches. And he goes, well, what do you think about end times then? I have waited 15 years for him to ask a question like that. And there it was. And I said, oh God, help me to step through. Thank you. Thank you. I've been trusting God and waiting on God in faith. Open the door. I stepped through the door, started sharing with him about end times, about Jesus, about what it means to be raptured, what it means where our soul goes when we die, all the questions. He had tons of questions about all of that. And he said, well, and I said, you know, but it all begins with a personal relationship with Christ. Have you ever accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? He goes, yes, I did. And he goes, and I still do it. He goes, but I'm not sure that I'm going to heaven. And that's what he said. He said, Pastor, I'm just not sure I'm going to heaven. And I said, so there was a time when you prayed to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And he said, yes. And I said, the problem is that you aren't reading the Bible. I said, do you have a Bible? He goes, I got some, but it's like the these and the thous and everything. I've tried reading it and I never understand a word in it. I can't understand nothing in it. And I said, well, I'll tell you what. I said, I'd like to get you a Bible then, one that's an easier Bible to read, one that has a little easier words and stuff where you might understand it a little bit better. And he goes, okay, that's good. That's good. That'll help. I said, yeah, it'll help. And I said, and then I want you to start reading in the book of 1 John. And he said, 1 John? He goes, what's that? He goes, I heard of John. Another guy told me one time to read John. I tried reading John, couldn't get past the first couple of pages. And then I started looking at how many pages there were in John. I didn't want to read anymore. And I said, well, look, start with 1 John. It's only 5 chapters, really short, just a couple pages. Read that. There's a lot about God's love and about how God wants to minister to you. And he went on and we talked about that a little bit more. And I said, Lance, I'm gonna leave right now and stuff. I want you to focus on 1 John, though. And he said, okay. He said, but I did pray to receive Christ. And I said, good. Then what you need to do is grow in God's Word, because the only reason you're not hearing from God is because you're not studying God's Word right. And I said, that's why you need a church. And he goes, come on, Pastor, you know me. I'm an outdoors guy. I love to spend my weekends outdoors. You know that. And I said, I know that, but maybe God wants to change that. And he said, what do you mean? And I said, maybe God wants to make you a church goer. And he said, I never thought of that. Maybe he does. And I said, maybe he does. So we said goodbye. I left. I ran as quick as I can. I went to Gospel Supplies. I bought him a nice NIV Bible. It was a devotional Bible. Actually, it was a college edition. And I brought it back to him because I had some good devotions in there, college devotions for him and stuff in there as well. Brought it back to him. When I got back there, it took me about 45 minutes or so to go get it and get back to him and stuff like that. And I bought him a brand new Bible, took it back to him, went in there. He was in the back room again. I came in. I go, Lance, are you here? And he comes out there and he goes, he's coming out with a Bible. And so he didn't know I was coming back. But he came out with a Bible in his hand. Guess what he was doing? Reading 1 John. I said, hey, I brought you a Bible. He goes, you what? I go, I bought you a Bible. He goes, really? He goes, do you want a free haircut for that? I go, no, I don't want a free. I just bought you a Bible. It's what I do. I want you to know God personally and stuff. And he said, oh, man, thank you. And so he opens up and he goes, I was just reading 1 John. I go, I thought you might be. And I said, now you can read it in an easier to understand language, and this will really minister to you. And we started talking a little bit more about the Word, and I started explaining to him how the Word impacts our lives and stuff like that. And you know, when I walked out only because we got interrupted by his appointment that came an hour and a half after I started. His next appointment came in and he had to get back to work. But he looked at me and he said, thank you, Pastor. And I looked at him and I said, I'm praying for you and I believe God's going to speak to you. I have faith that God's going to speak to you. And then I looked at him and I said, I know God is going to speak to you because he's already speaking to you. See, look, the reason I told you that story is because I want you to understand that's the way witnessing works. And most people don't hear from God simply because they don't know how to. And we can't be afraid not only to just share with them what Jesus has done for us, but we've also got to be willing to share with them how they too can hear from God like we've heard from God. And we can't be ashamed. We can't be embarrassed. We can't be backward or apologetic about inviting people to church or saying, you should be in church. That's where you're going to hear from God. You're going to hear the Word of God. You're going to learn how to study the Word of God there. You're going to learn how to do it on your own. You should be in church. We've got to have that kind of boldness in these last days, brothers and sisters. Amen? See, God's Word, we fill our mind with it. And when we do, we begin to know what God knows. We begin to know how to see the world like God does. It's called wisdom. And we begin then to be able to know the right decisions and make the right decisions. Well, first of all, there's the Bible. We hear from God through the Bible. Secondly, letter B, we talked about through godly Bible teachers. For example, have you ever been in a worship service or a Sunday school class with other people and you heard a teacher or preacher speaking and you think, man, that guy's speaking directly at me. He's talking directly to me. Well, do you know what happens in that moment? God is speaking directly to you. Amen. That's exactly what you felt like is what was happening. God was speaking directly. He's speaking through that teacher or preacher, but he's speaking to you. And you see, that's why you don't want to miss church. Because if you miss church or if you miss Sunday school, then you're missing a message that God has just for you as well as for others in the congregation. But God prepares preachers and Bible teachers with specific messages for the flock. And if the sheep aren't there to hear the message, how will they know the right path to follow or the right direction to take? And so when people miss church, a lot of the time, the result is that they just continue to flounder in indecision and they end up making the wrong decision. But without a doubt, God does speak through godly Bible teachers and godly preachers. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. But then letter C talks about impressions. God speaks to impressions. And impressions, when I talk about impressions, I'm speaking about inspiration, ideas, intuition. I think a lot of times women's intuition is God speaking. And I think guys ought to pay attention to that. I think a lot of times, guys, we ought to listen to that. When our wives have some kind of intuition about something, pay attention. Listen to it. Now, there's two extremes to this, though. There's the rationalist, and that's the one who says God never speaks through impressions. And then there's the mystic who says every impression is from God. Well, obviously, that's not true. I mean, you could have a bad burrito for dinner, and you get acid indigestion, and it produces some very vivid dreams. Amen? Amen? I mean, God can give all kinds of impressions, but so can jalapeno peppers. And the devil can give impressions as well. So that's why we're told in the Bible to test the impressions to see whether or not they're from God or not. We'll talk about that at a later date. But God uses impressions. But not only that, letter D talks about the fact that God uses circumstances. Sometimes the circumstances of life that God allows us to go through will determine what we can and cannot do. Sometimes the circumstances themselves make the choice for us. Isn't that true? I don't want to have kids, but I'm pregnant. The circumstance has already made the choice. Amen? Oh, no, I can choose to have an abortion. That's really the wrong path. Amen? That's really the wrong path. So, you know, some circumstances already make the decision for us. Some seasons of life make the decision for us. There are some rides in theme parks that I can no longer go on. Circumstances of life have determined that I cannot do that. If I get on a certain ride, I may not get out. Amen? Circumstances of life, the seasons of life that you're going through, they make decisions for you. I can't keep up with these little grandkids of mine like I used to be able to. I'd like to, but I can't. Or then, not only circumstances, and by the way, God does speak to us in circumstances. All of God's people said, amen. Amen, he does. But that's not all. Letter E also tells us that God speaks through pain. I mean, God whispers to us in our pleasures, but he shouts to us in our pain. Does God get your attention when you're in pain? Yes. You bet he does. Listen, you've heard the old saying, there's no atheists in foxholes. What that means is that when your life is on the line, suddenly God becomes very real. When your life is on the line. And when you're in that kind of pain, when you're in real pain, listen, it's not going to be Buddha or Muhammad you're calling on. You're going to be calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ when you're in pain. And so God definitely speaks to us in our pain. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen, he does. The point to all this is that God really is speaking to us all the time. Just like that, those cell phone signals are around us all the time. God is speaking to us all the time as well. We just need to get tuned in. So the question is, do you have your listening ears on? That's the question. Because if you really listen, if you really learn to tune in to God, God will lead you in the right path. He will lead you. But on the other hand, if you don't get in tune with God on a regular basis, then you're probably going to miss God's direction and you're going to wind up on the wrong path. And the wrong path can lead to broken dreams, it can lead to broken homes, to broken hearts, to broken lives. And we live in a society that is truly broken in all kinds of ways. But now listen, the good news is this. Listen, the path of righteousness is also the path of recovery. Amen. It's the same path. And when you come to God and you say, God, I'm way off path. I've missed it. I got off somewhere. I need to get back on your path for me. Folks, that's the road to recovery. And God can turn your life around. He's done it for millions and millions of other people, and he can do it for you and I just as well. Sometimes, though, God is going to lead you, though, now listen, in paths that may not always seem to make sense. Sometimes God's path may include a tragedy of some kind. It may involve a crisis of some kind. It may involve a lot of pain. And sometimes the path that God has designed for your life is going to make you wonder, what in the world is God doing here? Surely I must be off the path. I mean, I feel like I'm in pain. God, this can't be the right path. Yeah, it may still be the right path. So what do you do in those instances when you can't figure out what in the world is going on? Well, and that's when you take this fourth step, and that's this, number four on your outline there. I need to trust God when I don't understand what he's doing. I just need to trust him when I don't understand what he's doing. You trust God because you're not God. You're not God. And so God is the one you trust, not your senses. Not your senses. Listen, don't trust your senses when it comes to elements of God. When you ask God for something, don't just trust your senses. And a good example of this is when the children of Israel were finally set free from Egyptian bondage. See, the whole nation of Israel left Egypt. They started marching toward freedom, only to find themselves pinned up against the Red Sea, and Pharaoh's army is hot on their trail. I mean, the path that God seemed to be leading them on suddenly came to, bam, a dead end. No place left to go. But God knew exactly what he was doing. He was preparing them for a miracle, for ultimate deliverance, because that's where their path led. See, God knew what he was doing, and even though they couldn't see it at the time, all they could do was trust him. See, what God did was he just opened up the Red Sea. God made a path for them, and once they went through, God closed the Red Sea on Pharaoh's army when Pharaoh's army tried to follow Israel. See, the point is, you cannot follow God's path without a personal relationship with God. If you want to walk with God, you got to really know God. Amen? See, the nation of Israel would always remember God's deliverance. They would always remember that. In fact, look at what Israel used to sing. Whenever they would remember the deliverance from Egypt, the Passover, this is what they would sing. It's Psalm 77:19. They would sing this at the Passover. Say, your road led by a pathway through the sea, a pathway no one knew was there. A pathway no one knew was there. Listen, when you cannot see how God can lead you any further down the path you're going, when it looks like God has led you down a path that seems like a dead end and your back's up against the wall, don't panic. Don't panic. Don't panic. Instead, it's then that you need to trust God, because God, listen, is still working. Look, God is still working. Amen. I feel trapped. I can't get out of this thing. God's still working. Don't panic. Don't panic. Trust him. And if it takes a miracle for God to lead you down a new path or out of that, then that's exactly what God will do. And sometimes God wants you to stay right there for a little while. Stay there. Stay there. Remember, he makes me lie down. Sometimes he makes me stop. He may have to do that sometimes. That's part of his journey for you. I mean, right now, some of you are facing some dead ends, and you think, man, I got a financial dead end. I can't go any further financially, or I've got a dead end job, or I've got a dead end relationship. It's going nowhere, and you're not sure if this thing's going to work out or not. But listen, you need to realize that that dead end is not a wall, but it's really a door, and it's a door that God can open at any moment. It's a door that God, it's a path that you don't even know is there. And the path you may be on right now is one that may seem dark and discouraging, and you may feel even depressed about it. And you may think, man, there's no way that this is going to work out. It's impossible. My friend, that's when you trust God. Amen. Let the trust that you have in God at that moment pull you out of depression. You know what will happen when that happens? You're fine with whatever God does then. Amen. And God says, now you're ready. Now you're ready. Because now you're really trusting me. See, if you just keep moving on in faith, if you'll trust God when you don't see a way, God will make a way. And when you start to think that it's not going to happen and it's not going to work out, hang on, because God is going to make a way. If you keep walking the path that God has put you on, no matter how hard it may seem, at that moment, it will become clearer and brighter the longer you stay on the path. Look at this next verse. Are you still with me? I got a few minutes. Look at this next verse. It's Proverbs 4:18. It says this, the path of the righteous. Oh, I like this verse. The path of the righteous, the right path, is like the first gleam of dawn, shining brighter until the full light of day. Listen, just like the sun breaks the darkness at dawn, the Son of God has a way of doing the same thing in the path that He's leading you on. It may seem not so clear right now, but hang on and keep going because it'll get clearer. No matter how hard or tough or painful your path may seem right now, one day God's going to help you to see exactly why He chose the path that you're on. One day the full light of His understanding is going to surround you and help you to see how His path was the right path all along. But what do you do in the meantime? You do what Proverbs 3, 5 through 6 says. Look at it. It's the next verse. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him and He will, say it, He will make your path straight. He said, don't lean on your own understanding. That means don't try to figure it all out, because you're not going to understand most of the things that happen in this life until you get to heaven anyway. Amen. So just don't lean on your own understanding. Trust Him. Trust Him. Hey, that's the best you can do anyway, is to trust God. God knows what's best for you. God hasn't made a mistake. God knows what He's doing. So trust in Him. Amen? Amen. Look at this next verse on your outline. Psalm 37, 23 and 24. It says, the steps of a man are established by the Lord. When he falls, he shall not be hurled headlong, because the Lord is the one who holds his hands. We're not walking this thing alone. We got God with us. Amen? Amen. Got God guiding us. Steps of a man are established by the Lord. Listen, before you were born, God developed a plan for your life that was custom made just for you. God's not going to force you down the path, but you have to choose to accept God's path for your life on your own. But He's got a path for you. And the path that God's chosen for you, well, ultimately, folks, it's ultimately going to end up in heaven. But it's up to us to choose the right path to follow, the path that God wants to lead us down. See, you and I, we need a shepherd. We do. We need a shepherd who will lead us down the paths of righteousness. And as we follow God down those paths and down that path that He's chosen for us, it won't be difficult to make the decisions we need to make in life, because we have a shepherd who wants to lead us and guide us. God's antidote to indecision is this. One, admit you need a guide. Admit it. Number two, ask in faith for God's direction. Ask in faith, believing faith. Number three, listen then for His response. The word, right? Pain, circumstance, all those things that we talked about, godly teachers, listen, because He has a response for you. And then trust God when you don't understand why the response leads you into a darker situation. Trust Him. Trust Him. And God will lead you down that path of righteousness. It may not always be the easy path. It definitely probably won't be the popular path. As a matter of fact, it'll probably be in complete opposition to the way everybody else is going. Amen. But God will sustain you and God will bless you as you choose the path of righteousness. The last verse on your outline there, Proverbs 17:28, it says, in the way of righteousness there is life. Along that path is immortality. That's a good deal. To walk God's path is life, abundant life, and immortality. That's where my confidence comes from. My shepherd. Amen. The one who watches over me, who died for me in my place. Amen? Amen. Let's stand up and let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord. We thank You for being our shepherd. We thank You for guiding us and for leading us. Father, we admit that we need a shepherd. Oh God, we need a shepherd. So Father, I pray that You'd help us to be willing to get before You and ask the questions that need to be asked, and then wait for an answer. Lord, there are things that we know that we should do without question because your word is clear. You've given us a conscience. You've given us direction in your word. There are decisions that we don't have to wrestle with at all because we know they're just the right and good things to do. But Father, in those moments when we're facing issues that we're not sure what to do, we're not sure if we should invest in this or go this direction or turn right or turn left. And Father, we're just in those moments, help us to turn to you first and foremost, and then to wait for an answer, to trust you enough that we'll wait. We'll wait for direction. And whether you give it to us through your word, or whether it's through the circumstances of life, or through pain, or whatever method you choose, Lord, we're listening, and we'll wait for an answer. Father, we follow you. We want to follow you. You're our leader. You're our Savior. You're our shepherd. Do in every heart this morning, Lord, what only you can do. We surrender ourselves to your leadership and to your guidance. Help every person here to better learn how to hear your voice every day. Help us to learn that every day, better and better and better. And how to better be able to discern your will. Thank you, Lord, for every person who's here today. Bless them as only you can do. For we ask this in Jesus' holy name.